This is Life Center Around the Table with your host, Paul Martini.
Welcome to Around the Table podcast at Life Center. I'm your host, Paul Martini, and I am so excited and honored really to have our next guest on this show. We've been following a lot. I know a lot of people at our church has been following the Chosen TV series that has been just a smash hit. And before we get into it, if you haven't watched The Chosen, get ready, you know, download the app. We'll talk about all that. But I just want to play a little teaser trailer. It's about 1 minute, and then bring our guest on. So here it is, The Chosen teaser trailer.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives. And recovering of sight to the blind. To set at liberty those who are oppressed. And to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor.
What do you want from me?
Follow me.
Guys, you have to check out this show. Listen, our worship pastor, David Leach, one day came up to me and said, man, I just watched this show, the first episode. It was amazing. And I'm like, oh, okay. And he tells me it's about Jesus and the Bible. And I said, you see some of those things and they're not done with excellence all the time. And so, he sends me the link and I watch the show with my wife and we are weeping by the end of it, totally hooked. And if you ever are looking for stuff, there's a season one disc set you can get. There's different merch. We'll talk about that later. But the creator, the co-writer, and the director of the Chosen TV series is with us today. His name is Dallas Jenkins. Dallas, thank you so much, first of all, for coming on here, but even more importantly, for writing this show.
Oh, well, that means a lot. And I love seeing that trailer. That was actually the very first thing we ever did, almost 2 years ago. Was just from the first four episodes, because we just did the first four episodes. And then there was like another half year or so, and we did the next four. But that was the very first teaser we ever put out, just to kind of get people excited about things. So that was a nice trip down memory lane. It's been come a very long way since then. But thanks for having me on. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a privilege to have you on here. You've definitely developed so much more since those first four episodes. I love the story of how this all started. Let's get into that first. So how did this all start for you? I mean, you know, I know that you've graduated and you've done movies before, you went to school for all this and, just knocked it out of the park in so many other films, but how did this one start?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I had done pretty well on some previous films, but it was actually my biggest career failure. That actually is what caused The Chosen to become a possibility, which I guess is how God works sometimes. But I had, even though I had been making movies for about 15 plus years or so, it had always been done independently. And my dad and some other investors, they were always the ones who financed my films, and we were able to have some degree of success. But I always wanted to kind of get Hollywood's approval. You know, when I would watch the Academy Awards, that was my ultimate goal, was that someday I could win an Academy Award and to work with some of these big producers. And I finally got that opportunity. And in 2017, a feature film that I did in partnership with some of the biggest producers in Hollywood, who had seen a short film I had done, really loved it, wanted to get into faith-based films. They were really intrigued by the idea. They thought there was a good financial opportunity there. And liked my work and thought I could be kind of the catalyst for them to get into more faith-based films. And the movie was called The Resurrection of Gavin Stone. And if you're watching this and haven't heard of it, that's part of the problem, is that when the movie came out in January of 2017, not enough people saw it. And so on January 20, 2017, which was inauguration day, I'll never forget that date, but that's when The Resurrection of Gavin Stone was released in theaters. And within a couple hours, you can see the numbers, and the math is all laid out. Like, you can, you know how that's going to do the rest of the weekend, you know how it's going to do for multiple weekends, and you can tell within a few hours, the math always adds up. And in a couple hours, the numbers came in, and it was a total bomb. The figures were lower than their lowest projections. And immediately all of the producers and studios that had been involved just kind of said, well, I guess we don't understand faith-based filmmaking. We're going to pull out. And all these plans that we had had to do more films, in fact, I'd already started developing another film, they all went away. So in just 2 hours, I went from being a director with a very bright future to a director with no future. And I was home alone with my wife on a Friday afternoon, and we were crying and praying and confused and thinking, where's God in all of this? Like, apparently we thought God had opened so many doors to allow this to happen that now that it's a failure, I guess it wasn't God. I guess it was just our own selfish motivations, and maybe we just missed the tea leaves, you know? And God laid it on my wife's heart very, very powerfully, very clearly, almost as clear as if you heard an audible voice. You know, read the story of the feeding of the 5,000. And then she felt this phrase from God, I do impossible math. We didn't know what that meant exactly, but we thought we could figure it out. So we went and read the story of the feeding of the 5,000. One of the things we noticed about that story that we hadn't really noticed before is that the hunger that led to the miracle, so the desperate hunger that all those people felt when they were listening to Jesus, wasn't a surprise to Jesus. When the disciples came to him and they said, we need to send these people home to get food. And Jesus said, oh no, we can't send them home. They'll faint along the way. That's how tired they are. Well, it was actually his fault that they were that hungry. He had been speaking for 3 days. So not only was he not surprised by it, by the problem, in many ways you could say he actually caused it. And so that actually made us think, okay, maybe God is bringing us here for a purpose. Well, then this phrase, I do impossible math, huh? Well, assuming that's actually the Lord speaking, maybe the math that Hollywood knows is going to be upended, and these numbers are going to turn around, and we're going to make this great point to our Hollywood partners that that maybe they shouldn't speak so soon. We thought the numbers were going to turn around. Well, they didn't. They didn't get better, and nothing changed. And so we didn't know exactly what God was doing, and I couldn't quite figure it out. Well, that night at 4 o'clock in the morning, I was doing what I do best, which is analyzation. I'm doing a 15-page memo talking about everything that I did wrong and all the things that I could do differently. And we call it a post-mortem, which is, I'm sure you even do this at church sometimes. Wow. You know, after the first service of the weekend, you analyze what went wrong, what went right, what went wrong, how do we improve it for the next one? And so in the middle of this big memo where I was analyzing everything at 4 a.m, I get a Facebook note from someone I've never met. We've just been Facebook friends for a few years. He didn't say hi, he didn't say hello, didn't say heard about your movie. He just said, remember, your job is not to feed the 5,000. Your job is to provide the loaves and fish. And wow. I thought, the first thing I thought was, has my computer been recording what my wife and I have been talking about all day? Like, I was so confused. I didn't say anything about this publicly. Like, how would he know to say that? So I said, what are you doing up at 4 a.m? He said, well, I'm in Romania. I'm on a different time zone visiting my brother. And I said, before I answer you, can you please tell me why you told me that? And he said, oh, that wasn't me. God just wanted me to share that with you. And that moment changed my life. I've told this story 100 times and I still get emotional because that moment in so many ways changed my life, because I knew God was there. I knew God was present. I knew God was in this probably more than almost anything I've ever been part of. And was clearly reaching to me. And so often we're reaching for God and hoping that he hears us. And this was God going, you need to listen to me. I'm reaching out to you, whether it's through your wife or whether it's through someone you've never met. I have something for you. And I didn't know what it was, but I was okay with that for the first time in my life. I didn't need a five-year plan. I didn't need to know the future. I just knew that I wanted to make whatever loaves and fish that I provided to be the best they could be, so that if God deems them worthy of acceptance, I know that that's where the transaction ends. Mm. And as a results-oriented guy, I don't need to worry about the success or failure as long as what I'm doing is what God wants me to do. And so I changed. I changed as a person. I became someone who genuinely didn't care whether I got approval from an audience or from Hollywood or anyone else. I just wanted to make sure God was okay with my offering. Now, of course, that doesn't mean you don't do anything. I mean, God could have just waved his hand and just had loaves and fish appear in everyone's laps, but he still had someone provide the five loaves and two fish. And then when it came time to multiply them, he had them distribute it. So that's what allowed me to be open-minded to the next opportunity I got, which was for my church. And this is why I love talking to someone like yourself, talking to churches, is because I do have a passion for the church having tools in their tool belt to bring people closer to Christ.
Yeah.
And so when it came time to, I had this opportunity for my church to do a Christmas Eve short film about the birth of Christ from the perspective of the shepherds. It's an idea that I'd had for about a year and a half that I was really excited about, but I never had time because I was doing these big movies. You know, I did a big Hollywood movie. And now I've, you know, got a chance to do this little short film for my church. And it felt like a significant step down, but I didn't care. I'm just like, well, it's one small loaf and one fish, but that's all that's all I care about. And while I was doing it, that's when the idea for The Chosen came into my mind, which is, you know, while we're doing the short film about the birth of Christ, but from a different perspective, the story isn't changing, but we're adding some historical context, cultural context, artistic imagination to what led up to the famous story in the Gospels. And I'm like, I feel like I've learned more and my eyes have been opened more to the birth of Christ just by doing it this way than I ever have. And so when that short film got in the hands of the streaming service, who heard my idea for the show and got excited, and they said, we think we should raise the money for this show through crowdfunding. And I thought that was ridiculous. I thought there's no way this is going to work because crowdfunding never works. And it's always for small projects and that have, you know, the one, you know, that you see on Facebook or social media, someone's trying to raise money for something, never works. The all-time crowdfunding record was $5.7 million from two projects. One was Mystery Science Theater 3000. The other one was Veronica Mars. And they had big fan bases already. And I'm like, I have no fan base. And I've got this short film that I did on my friend's farm in Illinois for my church's Christmas Eve service. Well, that short film that went out on social media, here's why I was okay with it. Loaves and fishes. It's not my job to feed the 5,000. It's not my job to worry about whether this is going to work. I've done everything I can do. These are my loaves and fishes. And we'll see what if people respond to it. I remember when we were sitting at my computer the next year and we reached the $10 million mark, shattering the all-time crowdfunding record from over 19,000 people around the world, all based on that short film I did on my friend's farm. And my wife turns to me with tears in her eyes and she just says, I do impossible math. And just as clearly as the first time God had told her, he was telling her again, this is what I meant by that. And you don't at the time, you sometimes question, is that God's voice or is it ours? We don't know. And we don't understand it perfectly, but we knew, of course, in that moment what that meant. And that phrase, I do impossible math, has been the hallmark of our show from day one. Is, I mean, even just this year in 2020, The Chosen was doing fine. It was getting some attention. And it wasn't until we started making it totally free and totally easy to access, all 8 episodes, every country in the world, totally free, because streaming costs money. And I'm sure you know that, because even just what we're doing right now, people watching it, it actually costs money. And we thought we can't give it away all over the world because we'll lose too much money. But COVID hit and we thought, oh, let's do it, because even just for a couple of weeks, just as kind of a gift to the world. And that day that we did that, our income quadrupled and quintupled and hasn't looked back. And the show has exploded because people are now paying it forward, because we make the show free, but we say, if you have the means to pay it forward and allow others to watch it for free, you can do so. And I know I'm skipping ahead in my story. You were just asking me.
So good. This is so good. I'm getting goosebumps, Dallas. This is such a great story.
but everything has been a tapestry. You know, it's all been, it's not like God just said something to us and then that was the end of it. I mean, the loaves and fishes concept, the I do impossible math concept, that has all been it's plastered on the walls of all of our offices, figuratively. I mean, which is every time that something is challenging, which has nothing about this project has been easy. It has been a slog since day one. We call it the chosen curse. It's like the moment people even get involved in the show, they start having marital issues. It's like the enemy is just going after it full bore. And yet we just keep, when we come up against it, it's like, I'm a different person than I was 3 years ago. I'm like, hey, now my job to feed 5,000. Like, this is God's project. I'm putting the loaves and fish together. We've done everything we can possibly do. The rest is up to him. And every time the response or the answer has been infinitely better than anything we would have come up with on our own.
So good. That's such a faith response too. I mean, it just, you know, and that was one of the questions I really wanted to get to you is that, you know, and I think it's kind of a leading question, but you know, do you feel like this is more than a job, but actually a calling on your life? Like, this is a God-given call on your life.
Yeah, that is a bit of a leading question because, of course, there's only one right answer. I can't say no. Actually, it's just a job. No, you're absolutely right. This the job piece, the fact that my career now, and this is true of my family too, because it's been challenging for my family quite a bit. Besides just the spiritual warfare, but right now, I'm talking to you. I'm in Utah, and my family's in Illinois, and for the next 2 months. We're only going to get to be together for about 10 days, which is extremely difficult. But they've said, including my kids, that this would be really tough to deal with if you were just going off to, you know, a conference, or if you were just, you know, I think my daughter said, if you were just a businessman, this would be really difficult. But knowing that what we're doing has actually, and I'm not just saying this it may sound arrogant, but what we're doing. And what God is doing through us is a more accurate way to say it. Mm-hmm. It has resulted in literally millions of people saying that their lives have changed because of it, and that they're closer to Christ than they've ever been because of it, and that they're reading the Bible more than they ever have because of it. That the job part, the fact that I actually get to pay my mortgage because of, you know, being hired to, you know, because of what being able to tell these stories. Is like, that's gravy. I mean, that's just like, that's the, like, I can't, shame on me if I ever complain about anything. The fact that I get to tell the stories of Jesus and even myself get drawn in closer to Jesus because of the discoveries that I feel like I'm having just from doing the show. The job piece is look, as long as we can feed my family and pay our bills, that's all that matters.
Yeah. And, you know, it's such a great story in and of itself, and just developing and producing and directing and creating the first season is an amazing feat. And if I never heard of your show, Dallas, and you showed me what you did, what God did through you, I would say that's an amazing feat. But let me read you some statistics. You have over 50 million views. You're in 180 countries with 50 plus languages. Listen to this, guys. 100% on Rotten Tomatoes and 98% from the audience. I've never heard of that on any show. And of course, you've already mentioned you're the number one crowdfunded feature, you know, film ever. You know, you've grossed the most on a crowdfunding. So, I mean, you know, developing a movie is amazing. Developing a successful movie is amazing. But if you ask any Hollywood producer for 100% on Rotten Tomatoes, I mean, that's, yeah. I mean, people would be happy to get 60%.
Yeah. Well, to be fair, I'm guessing that number will start to go down a little bit as more critics start to see it. I don't want to get too pumped up about the 100% tomatoes because I know it's a handful of critics, and I'm sure that'll go down eventually. But here's the thing. That I hope you understand what I mean when I say this. Mm-hmm. Those numbers reflect impossible math for sure, especially the crowdfunding and the views and all that. Those numbers we use to sometimes convince other people to watch the show, because there are people who are like, this is going to be cheesy because it's Christian, or it's on an app. I don't, if it's not on Netflix, if it's not on the major network, it's not real. I don't care about it. Mm-hmm. So we give them numbers to assure them that that this is a growing and popular show, but I genuinely couldn't care less about the numbers. And that is a really, like, that is a superpower.
Awesome.
Because when you truly get to the place where you only care about making sure that your loaves and fish are the best loaves and fish that you can make, and that you just want to be a good baker and a good fisherman. I know it sounds cheesy, but like, I genuinely, and I used to for 15 years of my life, I believe I was a narcissist. I believe that I struggled with narcissism, and then I really attacked it a few years ago, and I've become a different person, but I genuinely don't care. When I'm sitting in front of the computer screen and it's a blank page and we have to write season 2 and 3 and whatnot, the blank page doesn't give a rip about any of those numbers. It doesn't make things easier. It doesn't make what I'm about to do in just less than 2 weeks. I'm gonna be filming season 2, and it's not gonna be any easier. In fact, it's gonna be much harder with COVID and all the hundreds of thousands of dollars that we don't have that we have to spend on safety protocols. I mean, it is a slog, and I don't care about whether or not it results in better numbers. I just want to be at the center of God's will. I want him to be pleased. And I want, when I'm sitting down to write, to be able to continue to listen so that what I'm doing is as good as it can possibly be. And it's never going to get easier just because those numbers are high. I've still got 6 seasons of The Chosen to make that are about the creator of the universe. And I better get that right.
It's amazing. Yeah, absolutely. I love it. What a great response. Well, let's talk about the writing. You know, there's so many different angles and different character storylines you could develop. I know you have a couple people who help you write these things. How do you decide who to highlight in what season or what show? And how's that process done?
That's a great question. So when we first sat down to do the show, and plot out season 1 and what the show is going to look like and who we're going to focus on. So we chose as our 5 main characters, Jesus obviously is going to be one of them, but like other shows like The West Wing, for example, which is about the president, but he's not the only main character. It's an ensemble piece. So we chose Nicodemus, Mary Magdalene, Matthew, and Simon Peter. And we went into it looking at what are the stories we know in the Gospels and what can we determine from those stories that when we go backwards and create a backstory and create the context around those moments in scripture that we love so well, what are the most enriching stories that have the most, where the soil has been tilled for some really cool stuff. So Nicodemus, obvious, he's someone who had almost kind of a double agent. He had his foot in both worlds. He was a Pharisee, but also believed in Jesus as the Son of God, couldn't admit it. To the other Pharisees, he kind of stayed under the radar. He met with Jesus privately, didn't come out of the closet as a follower of Jesus until Jesus died. So we thought that was really interesting to explore. Mary Magdalene, the first person that Jesus chose to reveal himself to after the resurrection, when he met her, she was possessed by 7 demons. Well, that's certainly interesting. So we're going to explore that. Matthew, the tax collector, a guy who tax collectors were absolutely hated by the Jews, disrespected by the Romans. Jesus walked past Matthew's booth, said, "Follow me." And Matthew immediately dropped everything and followed him. Well, let's look into that. Let's see what could have caused that. So all of those things go into choosing our main characters. And then when we choose the miracles that we're going to focus on, choose the storylines we're going to develop, who are some of the supporting characters in the Gospels for our show that are really interesting stories. Our primary, we have 2 real significant factors that we look into. One, when we create a backstory or a context, is it plausible? Are the things that we're creating, because anytime you start creating something that's connected to scripture, it's dangerous. I mean, there are some people who won't even watch our show because they believe the only thing they should ever watch from the Bible is if it's directly from the words, and anything extra is heresy. And we've made it very clear, we're not the Bible. We're not replacing the Bible. We're a show. But anytime you do something where you're quoting Jesus outside of scripture, or anyone who's from scripture, but you're showing them outside of scripture, it's dangerous. So we want to make sure it's plausible, that it fits within the intentions and character of the Gospels and who Jesus and these people were. But the other thing is we really focus on the personal. That's the thing that we've discovered the most, is that Jesus wasn't about big epic miracles. He did a few of them, but for the most part, his miracles were always for a purpose, and it was usually to get at someone's heart. And so we're looking for stories that we believe the audience can genuinely connect with, and that has a personal result. So when you look at the miracle of the fish, for example, in episode 4, when Simon Peter has been fishing all night, mm-hmm. and Jesus comes to the rescue, it wasn't as interesting to us, the fish itself. It was what it does to Simon Peter, what it does to his heart, what it does to the people watching. And most of the miracles you'll see in season 1, and you'll see this throughout the rest of the seasons, are less about the miracle themselves, less about even the specific recipient of the miracle, but more about what it does in the heart of the people watching. And that's what Jesus always seemed to be about. It's why we show him getting into people's faces, kneeling down to their level, or lifting someone up to his level and saying, I see you, and I want to reach into your soul, and that's what I care about. This miracle is just a means to get to your heart. So that's what we're looking for, is people in the Gospels that we believe we can get to their heart in an emotional and spiritual way, so that the audience can connect with those people and say, huh, if their questions and their concerns and their struggles are the same as mine, maybe the solution is the same as mine can be.
So good. And I love how you did that. I mean, just even in episode 1, how, you kind of show this backstory for Lilith, you know, and then how Jesus meets her, you know, and I don't want to ruin it for people who haven't seen it. And then even wrapping Nicodemus into the storyline, just brilliant. And not Nicodemus. Yeah, it was Nicodemus, right?
Yeah.
So where does this, you know, you have 8 seasons. You said you're going to do 8 seasons, right?
7.
Seven seasons.
We originally were talking about 8, but I think we landed on 7. It's a nice biblical number too, so that helps.
That's good. Perfect completion. I think that's right. And then, so where do you see these? How far into the Gospels are you going to go?
Well,
is that a spoiler? I don't know.
No, I mean,
okay.
Well, spoiler alert, Jesus dies. I don't know if you knew that.
Right, I know. So most people should know what's going on.
Bigger spoiler, he doesn't stay dead. So Our job is to make sure that the crucifixion and the resurrection are as impactful as they can be. And so we just actually recently had a writer's retreat where we plotted out all the remaining seasons. And we start with where it's going to end, and then we work our way backwards so that we can earn those moments. I want the crucifixion season, which is probably going to be season 6, to wreck you and to wreck me. I mean, I want it to be, it should be painful. It should be tragic. And we should be wrecked by it. And the way to do that is to make sure that the seasons leading up to that, that you, and people are already saying this, just even after watching season 1, they're like, I can't even think about what's coming because I'm falling in love with these people and I'm feeling so close to Jesus. I'm like, I can't imagine what happens. And I'm like, all right, it looks like we're doing our job. That's good. But also the ending it doesn't end on the cross. And we want to make sure that season 7, our final season, is as powerful and as impactful and as joyous as it can be. So we've got a lot of work to do till then. But honestly, other than just kind of knowing where we're going to end, we try not to think too much about it. We really want to focus on making sure that season 2 is as good as it can be. Because season 2 doesn't live up to season 1, then people are going to kind of tune out. So we want to make sure that we continue what God wants done with the show.
Yeah, that's great. And I totally agree. I think it's great to just focus as well on making sure season 2 is as good as season 1. You've been building some, it seems as though the sets that you're doing for maybe even season 2 are sets you're building. Is that right?
Well,
are you doing different spots?
Yes, but I mean, I'm in Utah because that's where we're filming the first 6 weeks. Because there's this set in Goshen, Utah, that it was already built. It's a first century recreation of Jerusalem. And it's jaw dropping. I mean, it's unbelievable. I did a video on our YouTube channel. You just look up The Chosen, we're easy to find, from the set just a couple of weeks ago, where, I mean, this set is, it was unbelievable. The fact that we have the access to be able to justice real quick. The fact that we have the access to use it is extraordinary. And so a lot of that, we don't have to build quite as much on that piece of it because it's been done so well. But yes, we're also starting to literally break ground on some other sets that we're going to start building ourselves so that we can have a place to shoot for multiple seasons. So season one was filmed in Texas at this other set that had been built, kind of a first century recreation of Capernaum by this family in out in the middle of nowhere in Texas. And that was good for us for season one, but we're not using it all the seasons. And so we're going to be in multiple places building, using stuff that has already been built. But the goal being just to continue to try to increase our production value and give this story the quality it deserves.
Yeah, my wife grew up in New Zealand in Hamilton, and that's where Hobbit Town's built. I don't know if you know Hobbit Town.
Of course.
And it's now a huge tourist attraction because they haven't torn it down. It's just they've left it. And so whatever you build, just leave it so we can come visit it.
Yeah.
That's basically what I'm getting at.
Yeah, no, that's actually the plan. That's the hope is we've actually got a piece of land in Texas that we're in discussions with right now where our goal is to build some stuff that then can stay put and be used for educational purposes, for spiritual enrichment purposes. And then, of course, we just know there's already fans who would love to just see it. But it'd be great if we can figure out a way to keep it long-term so that people can actually get enriched by it. Because that's not, you know, you look at the Creation Museum and the Ark, there's a Ark experience in Louisville, I believe. Yep. But there's very little actually here in America where people can go and, they go to Israel to see where Jesus walked and actually, which is great, but it's actually very touristy. It's very difficult to kind of find kind of an authentic first century experience. Yeah. We'd love to try to do that.
Yeah. I would visit it. I mean, that would be phenomenal. Since the success of the show have people from Hollywood have now, reached out to you? Like, has Mel Gibson said, good job,
No, not Mel Gibson. But honestly, we've been pretty much off Hollywood's radar. I mean, we've been doing this totally outside the system. We're not on Netflix. We're not on the major networks. We have no one writing us a big check. We're totally just funded by people paying it forward and buying our the shirt that I'm wearing right now, for example, our DVDs and whatnot. That's all just keeping us going, and it's been outside the system. So I think Hollywood right now has too much to worry about, honestly. With COVID and with trying to save their entire business. But we've heard from, some birdies have told us that there have been some people in the business who've been like, oh my goodness, they raised $10 million from crowdfunding. Oh my goodness, they've got over 50 million views. Like, those are numbers we would kill for. So, but right now I think they're too busy trying to save their own streaming services. And that's fine with me. The more outside the system we can be, a little bit of an underdog story. I think our fans love that. I think they love that we're doing this outside the system. So I'm totally cool with that. But I would be nice to hear from Mel Gibson and just hear a nice job. That'd be fun.
I wouldn't be surprised if he does. Yeah. I really love the success of this crowdfunding thing. Do you see this kind of being the model for the future seasons as far as you see it? And do you think this will be a model maybe in the future for a lot of different projects?
Well, here's the thing. We've had many people reach out and say, all right, so we want to crowdfund. What's your secret? And that's a challenging question because I'm like, make a short film for little money that ends up, on your friend's farm that ends up, resulting in $10 million and God anointed it. I mean, there's not really any hard and fast rules about it. For whatever reason, God just, I think, touched that short film and touched people's hearts and it resulted in it because it's very difficult. So I don't know. For us, yes, for sure. I mean, we are soon to announce another investment round. So that's the interesting thing about season one. It's not donations. Season one was crowdfunded through investments. So we did an open, we raised $10 million. All those 19,000 people actually own a piece of the show, which we think is really cool. If you pay it forward, that's not investment. That's just supporting the show and you're getting, access to the season for free. You're getting to allow other people to see it for free. that's going to continue. That's kind of the engine that drives this project, as well as DVD sales and all that stuff. So, we're going to potentially open up another investment round to get people the opportunity, because we have lots of people who now like want to invest. They want to own a piece of the show. So we're going to maybe give that opportunity, and hopefully that'll be the last time we do that. Hopefully the pay it forward engine and the sales and the merchandise will continue to be enough that'll sustain the show for the 7 years, and we'll be able to shoot future episodes and seasons with that.
Yeah. I mean, I know a lot of different people in our congregation, as well as our staff, our senior leader, Charles Stock and Ann Stock, they love you. They love what you're doing. They love the show. They've, I believe their name's on one of the credits of one of the shows, and they're really, really great people. And then of course we also have other pastors, John and Brian Leach, who are pastors here, who love your show. Other senior pastors here. So we want to support you guys in any way we can. We don't want to see The Chosen not being developed. So if you're watching this, and I know that we have exposure even outside our church, but if you're watching this and you do enjoy The Chosen, sign up, give, get their merch. If you go on their website, you can get different journals like the 40 Days with Jesus journal. We pulled this from his site. Of course, you also have The Chosen DVDs, or you could just actually go on the website and give. And then they have some cool merch. I also see they got new shirts too, but we have some of these shirts that are there called The Chosen. And that's the fish, right? Going in one direction, right?
You see, yeah. So in the opening credits, you see a bunch of gray fish just kind of all going in one direction. And then one by one, 13 fish change to the color of life, which is teal. And they follow Jesus. And at the end, there's what you'll see up on the screen is there's 13 fish going against the current, going in the opposite direction, representing Jesus and the 12 disciples. So that's kind of our logo. And people love that because the shirts are not only extraordinarily comfortable, which I'm just saying that because we really wanted this to not just be kind of a crass commercial, you know, like promotion of the show, but Binge Jesus is a conversation starter. The Against the Current logo is a conversation starter. There's a line from episode 7 where Jesus says to Simon Peter, get used to different. And we have that on some shirts and some sweatshirts and whatnot as well, because we want to start conversations. We want the shirts to be things that people will actually wear and not just be like, here's a cheap shirt that says The Chosen on it so we can promote ourselves. We really wanted to be high quality. So yeah, thechosenmerch.com is where people can get the shirts and hoodies and hats and stuff like that. And so thanks. I appreciate you sharing that, because that really is how we finance future episodes and seasons. It's not just, you know, all just coming to me and I'm making a buck off this. This is, we pour it right back into the show, and it allows us to kind of keep the lights on as we do that. So appreciate that. Yeah. So the app is the best way. And I know you might have a few, there might be someone watching right now who's like, I don't want to watch on an app, but if you go to thechosentv.tv, there's an opportunity to download the app. And that's where you can watch all 8 episodes totally free. And the cool thing about the app is it connects our partners at VidAngel literally created technology that allows you to connect it directly to your streaming device. So Roku, Apple TV, Fire Stick, Chromecast, HDMI cord, whatever. You don't need a subscription. You don't have to pay anything. You don't have to sign up. You literally just connect directly to your TV through your
streaming. Right here, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I don't know how well you can see that. Actually, my camera's further away than just my computer. No, but it's a great, great tool. I love it. If you have Apple Play, you just kind of send it right to your Apple TV. It's very user friendly. So it's actually a great tool. You guys did a great job with that.
Yeah, and then if you don't, there's a lot of people who can't pay it forward, who don't have the means. You know, whether it's because their future is uncertain because of COVID. And they just don't have it. And that's great. Enjoy the show. That's why people pay it forward, is so that you can watch it for free. We don't want you to do it if you can't. Some people do. I think when they finish watching, I've heard from just thousands of investors or thousands of people who paid it forward who've literally said, I had to. I couldn't not. I just wanted to be part of it. I wanted to contribute my loaves and fishes in some way. And that's what we're doing. We're all contributing our loaves and fishes, and we're watching God feed the 5,000.
So great. So great. You guys are doing a great job. Dallas, how do you keep it all together? We'll wrap up in just a couple minutes, but you know, I look at responsibilities as a creator, co-writer, director. You have a family. I know you love Jesus with all your heart. You know, how do you keep that all those plates spinning? You know, obviously the grace of God is with you, but is there any secrets you got for us here at church?
Well, I think that, you know, I think in any ministry, because some people think, you know, people get really busy in their business and then they kind of do ministry on the side. And I think you understand this as well as anybody. Ministry oftentimes can consume you almost at the expense of a personal relationship with God, almost at the expense of your family. I mean, plenty of people in ministry have had family struggles or divorce or affairs or whatever it is, because I think what happens is you justify all the time and the stress because you're doing something for God. But that can be an idol, and it can get in the way of relationship, and it can get in the way even of your relationship with Christ. So I have worked very hard, and my wife works very hard to make sure that the show doesn't become an idol for us, because you can get even for good intentions, you can go, hey, we're changing the world. I mean, people are telling us their lives are changed. We got to work even harder. And, you know, that's an easy trap that the enemy can put you in, because all I can say as a piece of advice is it's not your job to feed the 5,000. It's only provide the loaves and fish. And if you can, I mean, so I am good. Not responsible. I'm not, and this is not false humility.
Oh, you just muted yourself. I think you hit something. Let me see if I can. You said that you muted you, so that's okay. Go ahead. You're not responsible.
I'm unmuted now, though, right?
Yeah, you're good. I can hear you now.
That's weird. I was talking, and I saw it just when you said that. I'm like, I don't know if I touched something. I'm very expressive. Yeah. So sorry about that.
That's all right.
But it's I'm not responsible for the 50 million views. I'm responsible for the show. I mean, of course, God, you know, anointed the show and did great things through it. But I'm responsible for making sure that the 8 episodes were written well and made and all that. But that's where the transaction ended. And if I start to feel responsible for the marketing and for getting it in front of people's hands and chasing down every opportunity and taking time outside of just making the show as good as it can be and as God honoring as it can be, that's going to add not only time and resources, but it's going to add a layer of stress that results in family struggles and results in being overwhelmed and results in vices and addictions and all of those things that come from being not just being focused on what's in front of you. And so, you know, the guys who the Kendrick brothers, who've done movies like Overcomer and Fireproof, you know, who experienced significant success. One of the great things that Stephen Kendrick said was, there are some things that other people can do. Like some other people can do the interviews. Some other people can go speak at a conference. Some other people can design the poster or whatever it is. But no one else can be your kid's dad. No one else can be your wife's husband. And so never, you know, one of the reasons I'm doing this interview on a Saturday is because I'm in Utah, but if I was home with my family, I probably would say, yeah, I need to postpone this until there's a time when I can do a better time for it, because I just have to try to focus on just the things I can control. And I'm responsible for 5 loaves and 2 fish. I'm not responsible for 5,000.
So good. Dallas, I really appreciate your heart and your message that you're carrying. Really, this is a message on your life. Would you pray for our listeners, maybe who are in a, you know, similar predicament, or, you know, and kind of speak into that? That'd be awesome.
Absolutely. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity just to have this conversation. As simple as it sounds, we even thank you for the technology and for the ability to like with the printing press, I sometimes feel like microphones and the internet are like tools to spread the message of the gospel. I pray for the person who's listening right now or watching right now, who isn't a filmmaker, but who does feel like they're responsible for feeding 5,000, or they're responsible, or they've lost the ability to carry out their dreams, or to sometimes even to provide. And I pray that you will, like you've done with me, like you've done with so many others, break us down, cause us to surrender and to give up on thinking outside of what you have for us right in front of us. And there's always something. You always have something for us each and every day that you want us to focus on. And it's usually you. You want us to focus first on you, and that when you can get our hearts, the rest is up to you. And so I pray that whoever's listening right now, whose heart does not belong to you, that they would give up their heart to you. And as Simon Peter said, when he fell to his knees in front of Jesus and said, at first said, get depart from me, I'm a sinful man. And Jesus wouldn't. That surrender, that piece of surrender, I pray that you will bring us to that breaking point where we're genuinely surrendered, where we feel like we're not worthy, but that's where you meet us. And I thank you eternally for that, that you meet us in that crisis moment. And so even as a movement of a great number of people is always preceded by chaos or confusion or tragedy, we ask that in our personal lives, that during this challenging year that it has been, that it would be the catalyst for a revival in our hearts and to be drawn closer to you. Thank you for doing that with me. And I pray that I never stop seeking that by being broken. And I pray that you'll do that for whoever's listening. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So good. Dallas, thank you so much for your time and your busy schedule. Again, we love you. Keep going. And we can't wait to see you soon.
Yeah, keep up the great work with what you're doing as well. I do consider this a partnership between the show and churches with discipleship. So thank you.
Hey, when things calm down for you, we'd love to have you out here.
That's a no-brainer for sure. Once we're able to meet indoors in large groups of people, and I'm not doing season 2, we'll for sure do something.
Awesome. Bless you.